Everybody, my name's Ford. I want to talk a little bit about some of the kind of follow-up and expansion work we've done leading off of Josh and Beth's presentation. I'm broadly interested in kind of the genomic basis of resilience and how things are happening at population scales. So what we really wanted to do was take some of the very specific work and build off of it and zoom out to see what's happening in a more kind of natural region or natural reproductive event. The questions we wanted to ask for this study are, is thermal tolerance heritable at a population scale and in a vertically transmitting species like Montipora capitata? As Josh mentioned, the species releases egg sperm bundles that are provisioned with symbionts. And like Beth mentioned, the different bleaching phenotypes we use have different symbiotic communities. We also want to see if, in the context of selective breeding, we can broadly improve thermal tolerance by using crosses of known tolerant parents, or if that is happening more kind of on an individual family basis. So all the work that I'll be talking about today follows what Josh mentioned about reef 13, which is on the windward side of Oahu here. And we wanted to sample and collect from corals that actually are going to be interacting and fertilizing, cross-fertilizing in a natural bleaching event. We have these bleaching histories from 2015. Like Beth mentioned, we've seen a lot of recovery. These appear to be very resilient corals. Now they're not able to be kind of visually determined other than the tags we have. But we put nets on 11 bleached and non-bleached corals and collected families. We did not make any efforts to standardize the amount of input from each colony, so all I can really tell you for now is that we had a really lucky night in July 2018 where all 22 of the colonies we netted actually did release gametes. We wanted to do this because some corals are more fecund than others, and therefore they will be contributing more to the kind of gametes in the water, and we're trying to get a realistic look at what that creates. So we brought our tuppers back to the boat. We mixed all of the bundles before they broke up from bleached parents in one bucket, from non-bleached parents in another bucket, creating what are kind of pure crosses. And then we took equal volumes of those two and combined them into a control cross. What's cool about this setup to me is that we're creating really high numbers of potential crosses, right? So we have 11 corals, excluding the potential for self-fertilization, that's 120 potential crosses. And for all 22, it's over 450. We're generating a lot of genetic diversity that's enabling us to look at what is happening at that population scale. So we've got those on the boat. They're fertilizing, as Josh mentioned. We brought them back to HIMB, and they're partitioned into a high and an ambient temperature at about 30.5 degrees for high and 27.5 for ambient. And then we monitored those over the coming days and weeks. So a very first pass is larval survivorship. So on the y-axis we have survivorship, on the x-axis we have time. And these two points represent the analysis or the collections we made to look at genomic patterns of selection and changes in different genes. So blue is ambient, red is high temperatures. What we see to start is that ambient, there don't appear to be very many differences between the two parental phenotypes, right? But that is not true at all under high temperatures. We have this massive decline in survivorship that's very different in our larvae that came from thermally susceptible parents, so parents that were bleached in the past, as compared to parents that did not bleach in the past. So we see that broadly, this is a heritable response. Most of the variants we see in survivorship can be attributed to the parental phenotype and not just the environment. This is the same figure, however, I've now added in a line that represents the cross treatment just for simplicity's sake, and removed the ambient. So now we have bleached larvae, non-bleached larvae, and the cross. What I want to point out here is we don't see very much difference between the pure tolerant crosses and the overall control cross. This has a lot of implications for assisted gene flow, I think, suggesting that once you introduce some thermally tolerant corals into the population, you are getting that boost. But on the flip side, it's also suggesting that we can't really elevate above what's already there, at least on the population mean level. The previous work by Beth and other people have suggested that there are individual crosses that do behave better, but we wanted to know what happens on a reef naturally when you account for everybody. And it doesn't appear that we're really kind of substantially changing that mean trait level. So larvae that survive past about a week in the ambient temperatures were provided settlement substrate and settled. We gave them a few days to do that, and then re-exposed those to the same temperature profiles. There's no juveniles, so survivorship on the y-axis, time on the x-axis. We found a very similar pattern. So Beth just presented about differences in settlement, but once you get the settlers, does the bleaching phenotype of the parents make much difference? And we found, yes, it does, and it also behaves quite similarly to survivorship patterns in the larvae. I do want to emphasize that these were not exposed to high temperature in the larval stage, but they were ambient and then settled and then exposed to high temperature. But again, we see that settled juveniles from parents that were bleached don't perform very well at high temperatures, but there's not any difference at ambient. And kind of encouragingly, we see that the bleached parents actually do better or about as well as both phenotypes at ambient temperature. So we do appear to be building some resilience at this life history stage and improving the thermal tolerance of these corals. We also measured growth. We found that in addition to differences in survivorship, we have significantly lower growth in larvae of the bleached phenotype at high temperatures that doesn't exist at ambient temperature. So physiologically, there's something compromised about that combination, not only how well they survive, but how well they grow and thrive in their environment. But this doesn't really appear to be due to symbiotic community. So I mentioned before that most of the bleached corals harbored only quiticopium. Most of the non-bleached corals had a combination, but were dominated by durustinium. And that's what we see here. So on the y-axis, we have proportion of durustinium. On the x-axis, we have time. So these are corals up top that were previously non-bleached, are cross, and are previously bleached. And I expected to see more of a trend over time in that the temperature stress was kind of selecting towards D. We don't observe that at all. We have a kind of slight change here, but I think it's quite difficult to interpret anything from that in the cross. But even so, we're not drifting away from D. That could be due to a variety of things. It could be selecting for larvae that have a combination or differential selection between C and D. It's hard to tell, but this doesn't appear to be a pattern that's being driven largely by symbiotic means. Well, after all that. Okay, so I mentioned before that we had collected data for sequencing. We did this right after fertilization and then again at 4 days. And we wanted, again, to get the population picture. So we took 50 larvae, put them in a tube, ground them up, and we extracted DNA from that entire pool as one sample. We have 5 replicates for each phenotype for each time. Now, despite my best efforts, I got this data back on Saturday. And I have been really trying to get something to show you guys that I did, and then it turned into a black and white figure that you can't see, so whatever. as a broad pass, on the left, we have non-bleached phenotype only of larvae pools. On the right, we have bleach. And if you could see this, what I would show you is over time, between the initial and final time point, we're observing what appeared to be quite small changes in allele frequencies, right? These two lines track really closely together. But this is almost 40,000 loci, and it's 250 larvae in the total pool. So each one of these small dips and changes in allele frequency is actually a shift in potentially hundreds of loci within the pool over time. And one of the things that we're going to be doing moving forward is trying to look at how this is happening in heat that represents selection happening for or against specific alleles that is not happening in ambient treatments. But also notice this shift here is representative of lots of homozygotes in the bleached, pure bleached community that is being selected against over time. I think that's kind of an interesting start. We're also going to be looking at fixed differences between the parental phenotypes. We sequenced all of the parents as part of this experiment as well. I'm trying to compare that very broadly with the differences we see in selection in the larval pools over time. We'll look at phenotype-wide patterns of selection, so not just individual loci, but the way allele frequencies are shifting over time based on the parents. And using some machine learning with fixed differences in the parents to do a bioinformatic assessment of the composition of those crosses. So We had to sacrifice a little bit of our mechanistic understanding of what's happening to get the zoomed out picture. But Beth mentioned that there seems to be higher fertilization in this process just between bleached parents. I'm hoping to use some of the sequencing data to determine exactly what's happening in that control cross treatment that is behaving about the same as the pure tolerant phenotype. And I think that's going to inform some of our ideas about assisted gene flow. So that, thank you very much, guys.